That was me in my 20s. No, I'm steering. Don't be confused with the other.
So, what I love about this picture, this is the racing crew, Serpo racing crew, and they know they're going to land really hard, so they're standing up. But look at the oar blades, they're still rolling. These are athletes. All right. Start. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the go, no-go decision for the whole fishing trip, not just going across the bar. So I'm going to talk about five things you need to consider. And there are five, so your hand is a handy checklist. One is the bar crossing outbound. The other is sea conditions once you're out there, that's wind and swell. The other is visibility, is there going to be fog? The other is bar crossing inbound, because now you're 10 hours later, completely different tide and conditions. And then what does the forecast trend look like? If there's a big storm coming or a big swell, you want to know that in advance. So five things. And kind of the way this is going to go, we're going to talk about the five things continuously, but I'm also going to give you some tools for handling your boat on a rough bar. If you guys are facing a big breaking wave on a bar, you've probably done something wrong because you shouldn't do it, most of you guys. But if you find yourself in that situation or it's marginal, there's a lot you can do with boat handling that can make that smoother and safer. I've got some videos that are kind of entertaining, some fails, some near misses. We're going to talk about the basics. Dan and I talked about the basics, that it's important enough. If he did it, I'm going to do it again because it's pretty important. Then we're going to talk about crossing a rough bar inbound. And then there isn't a quiz, but there's homework. So I made a little packet, and it has copies of some of the websites for October 11th last year. And I'm going to ask you to go through and make your go no-go decision based on each of those five factors. So. And I'm available at Yoda's Lounge afterward to talk about it or whatever you want to do, or we can have an iFish discussion. Okay. All right, so inbound, if you find yourself on a rough bar, don't let the following wave overtake you. That's the main thing to remember. Can you roll that for me? So if you let a wave overtake you, this is what happens. If you stay on the back of a wave, it's all good. So don't do that. You got to have somebody watching behind, because you don't have enough power or rudder to save yourself. Whereas if you're on the back of a wave, the seaward side, you're in pretty good shape. All right, now we're going to watch this happen. This guy loses his boat. And it's totally preventable. I want to roll. He's not looking behind him. He has no idea what's coming. At that point, his engine stalls. And that's how it ends up. So again, had he stayed on the back of a wave, this would not have happened. That is a totally survivable sea condition for that boat. And again, if you find yourself in that situation, you're doing something wrong. You shouldn't be there. These guys are Australians and New Zealanders. Mm-hmm. They don't close their bars. Okay. All right, now on the other hand, this is a series, if you could roll that please. This is a series of boats, small boats coming in big waves. I don't know how big those waves are, but you look at them, they're big. And every one of these people are going to be fine because they put themselves in the flat spot between waves, or they stay on the back of the wave. You'll see some of them turning around. They've got situational awareness. They're looking behind them. And they're okay. And boats will take a lot of water if you handle them correctly. And I'm not showing you this to glorify taking risks or anything like that, but we can learn a lot from studying what works and what doesn't. This guy.
Example, the difference between a series and a wall, too. That series came in behind him.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Right. Did you hear what he said? He said the difference between a series and a lull. Some of these guys are timing their passages to be in the lull. So if you find yourself crossing a rough bar, have somebody looking out behind you. It's very important.
Okay.
All right, this next one is probably the best one I got. And this is a boat that attempts to make an inbound bar crossing, makes the classic mistake, doesn't watch behind them, and darn near poops the boat, and then he goes back out and he does it the right way. Now this one is important because as he's coming in, the bar doesn't look that bad. It looks fairly flat. But he's coming up on a shallow spot and he's not aware of it, and a wave pops up right under him. So the takeaway from this, I'll show you in a minute, is if you're crossing a bar, even if it doesn't look bad, it's very good practice to find yourself on the back of a wave just in case it's worse than you think. Okay, what I was saying is if you're crossing a bar and it doesn't look too bad, it's very good practice to plant yourself on the back of a wave and act like it's bad. Because if something goes bad, something goes wrong, you're in the safest position. So go ahead and roll that. Why is that slow motion? Well, that's not supposed to be slow motion. But anyway, so it doesn't look so bad. He's doing all right. But there's a shallow spot that he's going to come up on. Sorry about the slow motion. Okay, so now it's popped up underneath him. And it's just like the animation showed. His motor is cocked over hard, but nobody has enough prop or rudder or horsepower to get out of that situation. All right, so now he's turning around. Maybe you could just help me out manually.
Did he turn around in that, what we just saw, or is this a separate incident?
Come again?
Did he come in and then turn around and go back out, or is he turned around in that?
He just
trough?
About tipped over, and then he went back out. Right. Way in the back.
Okay. So if you're going over the bar and you find that once you start to commit, you find that it's too much for you, is there a safe way to turn around, or are you committed?
You're committed. I mean, that's the default. You're committed. You're doing your best at that point. And you know, just a word about that. Oh, this is better. Okay.
Yeah, it's still slow.
Still slow. Oh. Okay, now this is his second try. Same boat, same conditions, and now he's not doing a real good job of staying ahead of the wave behind him, but he's doing a decent job. And this time he's fine.
Coming in on the same spot.
Yeah. This looks
like a smaller set.
I think it is.
And that's why when you first see it, it looks flat. That was a series that came up behind him that caught him on the first break.
Right.
Because you can actually see it building behind him. And then here he's more probably into the wall, but right on the back end of the series.
Right. But that, I mean, that's still 5 or 6 feet of whitewater.
Yeah.
So, okay, let's go on. Okay, so one more thing, one more shot of coming inbound. And is Matt Huntington here? Okay, Matt's an eye fisher. He does, he crosses the Neatarts Bar. He crosses the Neatarts Bar on a jet ski. He's a wild man. Anyway, the next video is his helmet cam coming in, and he does a picture-perfect job of staying on the back of the wave. But I have this one in here because he's following the red line into Neatarts Bay, and it's an unprotected bar, and it's breaking and all of that. So let's roll Matt here. Okay, go ahead and roll it. This is his helmet cam. And he's approaching the bar. And he's decided that's his way. He's on the back of it. That's his way. He's going to turn to the right. You can see how steep that wave is. He's not going over the top. It's scary. There you can see the wave. And right behind him is another wave in full break. But he's not going over the top. He's doing this just perfectly. Sticking with his wave. And pretty soon the wave's energy is going to be spent. It'll be white water and soup. And they'll open the throttle and hang it on in. So it's scary if you find yourself. The wave breaks in front of you. Spray comes back. Your eyeglasses are full of spray. It sounds like the gates of hell. But if you're ever in that situation, stay on the back. Don't pitch ball over the top. Can you back me up? Okay, just a word about bar crossings. It's kind of a sacred moment to me. I mean, this is where it's a dangerous part of the day. You want your crew alert. Nobody should be telling a fish story. It's not the time to be having a sandwich. Your gear should be tied down. Everybody should be alert, looking for crab pots or whatever, even if it's a smooth day, because there's a lot that can go wrong. So pay attention. You saw some of these near misses. These guys weren't even paying attention. Don't do that. Yeah, no life jackets. Right, right. Any questions? I like to take questions as we go along. Okay. So the basics, wind, fog, swell, tide, and forecast. This is the best book that I know of. It was published 40 years ago. It's out of print. You can still get copies at Powell's and some of the online stores. It's very readable. It's a lot of fun, and it's a great, great book. Willard Baskin. Okay, let's talk about wind versus swell. Wind creates chop in real time. When the wind stops blowing, the chop goes away. It's complete opposite of a swell. Swell, once it's created, it'll cross 5,000 miles of ocean. But no wind, no chop. And someone asked about rules of thumb for how much wind is fishable and how much is not. And this is what I've come up with. This is mine alone. I'm not a lawyer. Don't use this for navigation. Don't sue me. All that stuff. But the takeaway is, for me, the fun ends at 12 knots of wind. Once you get up above 12 knots of wind, it's just not as much fun anymore. People are starting to fall. People with old injuries are starting to get scared. People who might be elderly, they're in trouble. People are, it's too fast to drift for bottom fishing. So it's not necessarily a safety thing, but it's just sort of like the fun ends. But the happy zone, 0 to 10 knots, everybody's happy. I mean, there's no white caps, you maybe got some cat's paws, the drift is perfect, it's a perfect day. The transition zone, 11 to 14 knots, you get white caps at about 10 to 12. Is that right, Dan? 10 to 12? Yeah, okay, you start seeing the white caps. And I forget what the Beaufort scale is at. Is that four?
Three or four, okay.
You're going to have some of your guests from Oklahoma or whatever a little nervous at that point, so be aware of that when you're taking people out. You get up to 14 knots, and if you're bottom fishing, you're drifting too fast unless you've got the patented Joe Evans wind sock thing. Are you here, Joe?
No, Joe.
No. Then what I call the crummy zone, 15, 18 knots. You've got heavy white caps now, and most people don't want to be there, and some people are really, really scared. It's pretty hard to stand up and fish, and there's a real potential for falls and so forth. So not a lot of people will fish in that zone. You really want to avoid that. Up above 19 knots, it's just scary and dangerous. Don't do that. I don't know, Dan, what do you think? Is that about?
Yep, good rule of thumb.
Okay, all right. Okay, so a little tribal knowledge about the weather here on the Pacific Northwest. There's some things that are worth knowing. One is the trick of the quick summer morning trip, because in the summer, often the wind starts blowing at 10:30. If you can sneak out for a bottom fishing trip or a coho trip at first light and be back by 10, you might have a great day with very mild winds, even though it's forecast 15, 20 knots in the afternoon. So that's worth knowing. South winds, they're just miserable and notoriously unpredictable. And a lot of people won't even fish them. So avoid those. And then there's the late July blowout for you tuna fishermen. Often the first week of July is fantastic tuna fishermen. Tuna fishing people get all schooled up, and then it blows 20 knots the last 3 weeks. That's just one of our weather patterns to be aware of. And then the hot weather blowout. If it's really hot in Portland in the valley, that warm air is rising, causing a sea breeze, and it might very well be foggy. And then wind forecasts in Oregon are generally pretty, I mean, they're pretty unreliable, and there's a couple reasons for that. One is the weather comes from the west, and the west is the biggest wilderness in the world, and there aren't many weather buoys out there. They do their best with satellites and whatnot, but it's not like being, you know, in Detroit or something like that, where the weather forecasters have the benefit of weather stations thousands of miles in every direction. So the wind forecasts are just not that reliable in Oregon. And when you're looking at your wind forecast, if you see them changing every 4 to 6 hours, that means the forecast models don't quite know what's going on. They're doing their best, but they don't quite know what's going on. And then the weather buoy reality check. How many of you have the weather buoy app on your phone? That's pretty good, okay. For those of you that don't, get it. Because as you're planning your trip, you'll have a forecast, but you can also dial up the weather buoy and see how close the actual conditions are compared to the forecast. If the forecast says that right now there should be 10 knots of wind at the 50 buoy off of Newport, but you dial up the 50 buoy and it's 20 knots of wind, man, the forecast has a little bit of a problem. So that's a good thing to have in your pocket on your phone. Check it in real time.
Can you go back to your previous one? I want to take a picture of it.
Yeah, sure.
I got it.
Okay, so we're being videotaped right now, and Ocean is going to somehow put them online. I'll let you talk about that at the end. Okay, so this is one of my very favorite weather forecasting sites. This is put out by Surfing Magazine, and incidentally, the surfing community has weather forecasting dialed in because they, you know, their business is waves. Surfing Magazine Swell Watch is what it's called. And up along the top, you see swell period wind. This is wind, all right? It gives you a nice graphical. Which one is the wind?
Right, definitely.
All right, so you can click on wind, swell, or period. Do not use period on Swell Watch. It's always wrong. I don't know why, but it's always wrong. So this is wind. And you can see the color scale here. This is knots, right? And you can see the time of day. This is Monday, and it's broken up into 4-hour intervals, right? So this is from 6 to noon. So you can see wherever you are, you can see the wind direction, and you can see the wind magnitude. It's a beautiful, beautiful graphical representation. And if you were on the computer, what you'd do is you'd click through the hours, and you'd get like time lapse, and you could see the wind patterns coming and going. One of the best prediction tools that we have. I love this one. Okay, and on that one, you can do the same thing for swell, obviously. Okay, did I miss one? Okay. All right, so this is the NOAA weather page, and you're all familiar with the, you know, the NOAA weather on the radio or the printed text. But if you burrow a little deeper, you can get to the point forecast, the Mariner's weather matrix, that guy right there. And that'll give you the weather for a specific location that you pick. All right, so this is what you get if you go to that weather matrix, the point forecast. You can pick a selection, and what's important here is the menu. You see the menu? You can click which things you want to see, like swell, rain, thunder, and all that. What's important here is this one right here, fog. Okay? This is the only source I know that'll tell you if there's going to be fog or not at a certain place. So click on that one. And in this case, there isn't, because the fog is right here. But the other one I've clicked here is, can't see. Wind, okay, wind, right. So this tells you by time of day what the wind is going to be, or whatever you want to check. But the reason I have this here is that's the only place I know where to get fog information. Does anybody else know where to get fog forecast?
Out the window.
Okay. Now, these little flags, anybody know how to read these little flags? Know what these are about?
Tells you direction. Direction and velocity.
Direction and velocity, absolutely. Okay, so the direction is the direction of the flag, the main stem there like this. This is out of the southeast. Southeast wind there. This is out of the northeast. All right? So whichever way the flag is going, that's the direction of the wind. The little flag part, that's wind velocity. The long leg is 10 knots, the short leg is 15, or is 5 knots. So you can kind of look at this, and this gives you the direction of the wind, which is very helpful. What did I do? I escaped?
You killed it.
I killed it?
We stopped.
It'll take a while to reload.
Okay. Any questions while we're waiting? Yes.
The surfer website that you talked about, there's also like magic seaweed and surfers. I've heard some people say, well, they're all really only accurate on the wave predictions and what's happening on the beach, because that's all they care about is surfing waves. What is your opinion?
I like Swell Watch because it gives you the map and you can see. I don't use magic seaweed. I don't know it very well. But I think I kind of have that same impression. It's more oriented to what's breaking on the beach.
So it's not very accurate if you get more than 2 or 3 days out.
The comment was it's not very accurate more than 2 to 3 days out. And that's true. That's true for all of us.
Hey, Charles.
Yeah.
One of the great things about magic seaweed is it actually shows you the different types of wind sets. So there's the primary and secondary and tertiary winds going in different directions. So based on suddenly wind, if you have secondary and tertiary wind sets, and you go to mix sea, it's hard on the whole body.
Pete, you're not an old guy. Come on. The comment was magic seaweed gives you a variety of swell terrain information, and that's good information. So some of you like it. I'm not going to diss it. I just don't know it that well. Okay, go ahead.
I'm a yachter, and there's actually a website or an app for your phone called My Radar, and you can turn on the wind and you can open and close it up to as tight or as broad as you want, and it'll have the wind directions. I mean, right now I can see there's a storm up in the Gulf or a storm off of California. It'll show you the wind direction and the velocity by color, and you can open it and close it as far and as close as you want it.
Would you be willing to write that down and give it to one of the ocean people so we can publish that? That's great information. Thank you.
What's it called?
My Radar.
My Radar. Real-time wind data. Okay. All right, this is the location of the weather buoys that we have from NOAA. The one most people know is 50, right off of Newport. Do I have that right? No, 50's down here. Right off of Newport. We've got Wen way, way off Tillamook Bay, and one off the Columbia River. Get this phone out, okay? Or one like it, because it'll tell you what's going on at that buoy at the time. Wind speed, wind direction, swell height, significant wave height, everything. It's great. All right, this is a relatively new one to me. It's called Windy TV, so search for that. This one, yeah, Pete likes that one. This one is awesome. You set your location here. This is you control this with the mouse. I've got this set of twin rocks off of Tillamook Bay. You slide around wherever you want, and the arrows are the wind direction. You've got the wind speed here. And this gives you sun, cloud cover. There's a menu. You can dial in all sorts of stuff here. Here's your days, your time. And this has proven to be remarkably accurate. In my opinion, I get some people nodding their heads. This is a very, very accurate tool.
What's it called?
Windy TV. Windy TV. All right, let's talk about swells. And Dan talked about this, but it's really important. And the point Dan made is that we are getting swells from all over the world. At any given time, we're probably getting at least three swell trains from the Gulf of Alaska, Indonesia, Japan, whatever. They come from far away, and once a swell is built by wind, it is permanent until it crashes onto a beach. The wind chop goes away the minute the wind goes away. Not so with swells. They're even and regular, and at any given time, we have multiple swells coming in. So the swell forecast, any swell forecast you see is a gross oversimplification of what's really happening, because there are storms being born, and there are storms dying. There are storms that are established, there are little squalls out there, and all those swells are coming at us all the time. So you read, NOAA says 6-foot swell, that means that's sort of an average. The other thing about swells as they come from distant storms is the first series, the first steps from a distant swell, they may be 45 minutes apart. It's not for nothing that Dan goes down and looks at the bar for an hour, okay? The swells from a dying storm can be 45 minutes apart. So what this means for you is if you're out there, and I've had this happen to me. I always fish tuna in a wolf pack with several boats, and we knew a big swell was coming. It wasn't supposed to come in until 8 o'clock at night. We're out there 35 miles, and this big, this nice flat day, this big train of swells came by. Oh my gosh, did we get that got my attention. 40 minutes later, another one came by, and I said, we're going in, because that swell train was arriving early, and the first few sets. There's a lot of time in between them. We headed for the beach as fast as we could. My wingman stayed out. We made it across the bar. My wingman, you know, came in, and the swell had already hit, and he spent an hour and a half out there in the dark, locked out of the bar while the Coast Guard figured out a good way to get him in. So be very, very careful about swell trains from beginning and ending storms. There is no such thing as a sneaker wave. I say that with utmost compassion for those of you that have lost loved ones. Sneaker waves are the ocean being the ocean. Sneaker waves are series that come from storms that are being either dying or being created. It's very natural. It happens every day. Not every day, but it happens a lot. Oceanographers do not use the term. Surfers do not use the term. The news media uses the term because it kind of gives an impression. But they happen all the time. And you guys that fish the South Jetty at Tillamook in the fall, I just cringe because you get those big fall waves coming in and you're stuck in shallow water. End of sermon. Okay, period. There's a lot of concern about period. Period is the time between two wave crests. So if you're sitting out there on that oil rig with a stopwatch, and every time a crest goes by, you hit the button, you'll get a time. That time is the period of the waves. Now, you can have the same swell height with different periods, like right here. Same height, different periods. The lower swell is a younger swell. It came from closer. This swell came from a nearby storm. That swell came from a far away storm. But the farther away, the more the period extends. Okay, so now if you're in a powerboat and you're doing 30 knots, you're going bam, 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 right? You're hitting those close interval swells. You might think that's really bad, and it kind of is. On this one, you're going whoosh, whoosh, it's a lot smoother ride. But nothing is really simple on the ocean because this one, while it's smoother out there, has a heck of a lot more energy. So when it hits the beach, that long interval swell is going to peak up and have a whole lot more power. And the dory guys know this. So you know, there's no free lunch. This one's easier on the ocean. This one's easier when you're crossing the water. All right. This is a subset of the swell watch site that I like so much. Okay. This is a subset of the one with the map. You can click on this, and you can get the actual swell prediction, and here's the days, and this is the swell height, and you notice right here, this is what NOAA says for Sunday, okay? Southwest swell 6 feet at 9 seconds. Go over to Sunday, what you see is there's a full range of heights, right? You can have anything from 3.5 to Sunday, 9 feet. So what NOAA does is they do their very best to consolidate all these conflicting swell trains into one number, but that's never the number. It's always like this. There's always swells coming in from multiple directions. This, again, there's no sneaker waves. This is just the ocean being the ocean. Does that make sense?
Yep.
All right. Again, I'm not a lawyer. Don't sue me. This is what I use. Okay. But I kind of do a red light, green light system when it comes to swell. 0 to 4 feet, green light. I'm going fishing. 5 feet, yellow light, but I probably don't. It depends on what the wind is doing. It depends on the period. It depends on what the tide is doing. 6 feet, yellow light, but I'm probably not going. 7 feet, I'm not going. That's just me.
How big's your boat? You say?
I have a 22-foot dory, flat bottom dory. So anybody got any comments on that? Nay, nay. Any big boat guys? Any 30-foot boat guys here? What do you say?
I like the forecast. Let's see if I go.
Okay.
I look at the duration or the period between.
Yeah, absolutely.
5 foot at 14 seconds. Not bad.
Absolutely.
5 foot at 7 seconds. Crap.
Yeah, the gentleman said, I don't know if you heard, 5 foot at 14 seconds, that's a big, loping, long, easy swell. That's not bad. But 5 foot at 7 seconds, or 5 by 5, what they call a square swell, that's a crummy sea. You're just going to be slamming it.
Dan,
oh, Tim.
Will it change a 5 from a rose to a window?
Tim is asking about the interplay between the wind forecast and the swell forecast, and therein lies the art of deciding whether to go or not. Let me answer it this way. A long swell, okay, long period, a gentle swell. Let's take your 5 feet at 14 seconds. That's not a very steep swell, and the wind can blow on that, and it's not going to get a lot of traction, okay? So it takes a lot of wind to turn that into a big nasty sea. Now if you have that same 5 foot swell at a 5 second period, okay, so that's a lot steeper swell, you get that same wind blowing on it, it's gonna catch a lot more water. Okay? So wind, the same amount of wind is gonna turn that into a snarling monster and nothing flat compared to 5 feet at 14 seconds. That's I don't know how else to help you, Tim. I know it's a great question. It's a fundamental question. You're absolutely right to answer it, but the interplay is really complex. Do I need to talk about that more? Okay, well, let me talk about that a little bit more. You know, the forecast I hate the most is 5 feet at 9 seconds. That's just, I hate that because 5 feet at 9 seconds is not a bad ocean, unless the wind comes up. But it's a steep enough ocean, if the wind comes up, that turns into a beast really, really fast. 5 by 5, I know I'm not going. 5 by 14, I know I am going. 5 by 9 is right on that miserable edge where it could be good or it could be really tough.
That would affect the barge condition.
Yeah.
That period.
Yeah, Dan is saying the period will affect the barge condition, and help me if I'm wrong, Dan, but the longer the period, the more energy in the wave, and the more it's going to peak up.
You know, I don't know about that. Closer to coming, there's going to be less energy, correct? It's going to depend on the size, height-wise, the amount of energy in it. But knowing that if they break, a wave will, as it comes to the beach, will break more than once.
Yeah.
So the first break, a deep water break, would be the most energy. Those are the ones that, if you get in closer and it starts breaking, then the second, third generation, the energy continually gets spent out of them. The thing with on the bar, that longer period, the current's not going to affect it as much as the shorter period if it's an outgoing tide.
Yeah.
So it may lump up a little bit more and slow down, but you've got that area to play with. If it's, like I said, a 5 by 5, that's going to be a beast. It's going to, that current will break.
Okay, so Dan's pushing back a little bit on what I said about the longer period being more energy. It's just a lot of factors, and I'm not quite sure how to even unpack that.
Yeah. Height will depict how much energy.
Okay.
You look at those pictures I have in the circles.
Yep.
That energy is in that under the water rolling through. So the larger the swell, there's more energy creating that mass.
Right. Okay. Fair enough. Okay, tides. I'm repeating what Dan said, but it's important enough that I'm just going to do it. We talked about that. Dan and I did. Okay. So there are a dozen of these tide apps for your phone and your computer or whatever. And what's interesting here is look at the slope, okay? The bigger the tidal span between high and low tide, you only have 6 hours to turn a tide, okay? If you've got a 12-foot span versus a 6-foot span, you're moving a whole lot more water during that big tidal change. So that's why this number is really important, the height of the tide, right? Plus and minus. So with this big span, your tidal currents in the bays are going to be a lot faster. And in fact, on a big exchange, water level will drop 5 inches in 15 minutes. Think about that. That is a heck of a lot of water screaming out through the bays. So that's kind of the takeaway here. Yeah, and mind your range. All right, we already did this. How many of you seen the rapids in Neatarts Bay on a Big Ed? Or Tillamook Bay for that one. You get actual rapids, and you can get if you're coming in on an ebb tide, which is a bad idea, you're kind of running in place because you got 2.5 knots outbound. It's so choppy, you can only make 4 knots. So you're kind of running in place, staying in the danger zone, you know, just making 2.5 knots over ground. Not a good place to be. All right, I'm an engineer. I got to do a graph. What I'm trying to show here, and this is sort of what I come up with for Tillamook Bay, so the usual disclaimers, don't sue me. But what I've got here is swell height and the probability that the bar is going to be open. So with a 0 foot swell, there's 100% probability that the bar is going to be open, right? With a 9 foot swell, there's a 0% probability that the bar is going to be open. We're talking about high slack right now, okay? The very best ideal conditions, all right? So for Tillamook Bay, if you've got a 6 foot swell, there's about a 70% chance the bar will be open on high slack time. Is that about right?
Yeah, and that this is where, and you've shown it better than I have probably, but when you transpose the tide height graph and the current speed graph, that's why that's happening at those periods.
Yeah.
The more water you got coming out, the stronger the current's going to be, the more its effect it's going to have on the swell and on the conditions of the bar. It's just.
Yeah, Dan's pointing out what's coming next. Now I've added another line. And this is for a strong ebb tide, okay? The first line was high slack, the water's not moving. The second line is strong ebb. You got water screaming out of the bay. This whole curve shifts over. Okay, so that same 6 foot swell, we're on a high slack, you got a 70% chance of the bar being open. That same 6 foot swell, you're down to a 15% chance that the bar is going to be open. Okay, so this is why I'm saying there's, in the five factors, your outbound crossing is one thing, your inbound crossing is quite another, because you're on a different tidal cycle. So it might make sense for you guys to pencil one of these out for your own bar, your home bar. Not that you really need to refer to it, but just constructing it is kind of instructive. Does everybody understand this? Understand what I'm trying to say? Okay. So going back to Dan's presentation, there's five things, right? When you launch your boat early in the morning, how many of those five things is Dan going to take care of? How many is Dan's bar closure going to take care of? You got five things to consider. You got bar crossing outbound, bar crossing inbound, fog, sea conditions outside, and weather trend. How many of those concerns does the bar restriction address?
One.
If you've launched your boat, he's covering the bar crossing outbound for you because he won't let you do it if it's not safe. One. Who's responsible for the other four? You guys. Okay? So you don't get, it's not as easy as saying the bar's open, I'm going fishing. That's the whole point of the five factors. Okay? If you're outside and you're coming back in, and he's covering your inbound bar crossing, there's still four more other things you got to worry about. Okay? Okay, the trend, this is really important. You know, if there's a big swell coming at the end of your fishing day, you have the tools to know it, okay? You have enough of these satellite tools. You know there's a big swell coming in at 8 p.m. There's no excuse for not knowing that. But it may well come in at 6 p.m. It may well come in at 5 p.m. Or, let's say you went fishing on a 5 foot swell day and there's a 10-foot swell forecast for that evening. Well, you're rolling the dice, because if you're human and the tuna are really biting and nobody wants to go home, you stay out too long, you're going to be dealing with that swell. Or if you have a mechanical problem and you have to come in on a kicker, you're going to be dealing with that swell. So what you don't want to do is go out there when the conditions are deteriorating. leave yourself a buffer of good weather. It's really important. And there's something called a sucker window. The sucker window is that one day, we have terrible conditions, you have one day of good conditions, and then it gets terrible again. That's a sucker window. You can go fishing, but just know those forecasts could be early, late, whatever, something can go bad. And if you run into trouble on an 8 or 10 hour window, it's your bad. Did I break it again? Okay, we're going to have some more fun talking about outbound bar crossings now. We've done inbound. We're going to look at some more videos. And the basic thing with outbound is, don't do this. Keep your bow pointed straight at the incoming waves. Don't go at an angle. This guy's going at an angle. And don't go too fast, okay? And I've got some videos to illustrate this, but it's really important to keep your bow straight into the wave. All right, so here's some guy, and he's heading for trouble. His bow is not pointed straight at the wave. And this is how he ends up. I mean, it's just as predictable as can be. So if you ever find yourself in that situation, bow straight on, rule number one.
It looks like he's trying to straighten out if you look at his motor.
Yeah, but too late. A little too late. Yeah. You know. This guy hit with a little too much speed. And the distance from his feet to the... He's got a 20-foot fall. I don't know if he broke his leg or not. There's no need for that. You want to hit him at moderate speed. Just don't do this. And actually, he was okay. I don't know how. All right, this is put out by the Australians. And it's a great video. This shows how to do it with the rollout. And this is more what we'll encounter. Hopefully, you're not encountering breaking waves. But just up and over, fairly easy. You don't want to dilly-dally. You don't want to be in the danger zone much longer than you have to. But just kind of up and over, fairly easy. Keep it straight.
And you aren't allowed to use your throttle while going out. There's people that go out and they'll hit it between the waves.
Yeah.
And then they won't pull it back when they're getting ready to go.
Well, that's when you end up airborne.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You are allowed to use your throttle.
You are. You better be on your throttle. Okay. All right, this is an entertaining fail, and I'm going to ask you guys the three things this guy did wrong. All right, just go ahead and roll that. This was an expensive day. I think this is South Africa. I'm not quite sure. Nice boat, huh? People don't get. He should not have gone out. I mean, that's an $80,000 boat, and who knows who was injured. Don't do that. Absolutely. Good call. Good catch. What else did he not do?
He didn't square up to the wave.
That's right. He didn't square up to the wave. Absolutely.
Too much power.
And too much power, right? He did it all wrong. And it was costly. Okay.
Sure enough. At one point in that scenario there, is he likely to lose power from cavitation in that white water?
The question was, when will he lose power in that white water? And that's a great point. I'm glad you brought it up, because I failed to bring it up on the inbound stuff. When you're in white water, your prop will ventilate, because it's trying to work, you know, in a bubble air-water mixture. So you're losing thrust. That also happens when you're inbound, when you're on the back of a wave and it breaks. So all of a sudden your prop loses its grip. So you have to be very, very alert and on the throttle at all times when you're in whitewater, because sometimes it'll catch, sometimes it'll slip, and you really got to be on it. So it's excellent, excellent.
My first launch was that. Forgive me. My first launch was exactly that at Pacific City. Too much power. I was square.
Yes.
Square. But too much power, and I did that full-on jump. Not only will your prop lose grip, but your RPMs will go through the roof. Yeah. It will back out like you won't believe, and your gut response will be throttle down. My response was throttle to neutral, and the prop died. The motor just died when it hit the water. Now I'm dead in the water in the circle. Not even close.
Did everybody hear that?
No.
No, okay. Tim's a dorymen, and one of our best dorymen. He said his first launch, he went with too much speed, and his prop was in the white water. And what is it you said, Tim, when
RPMs.
You're...
RPMs. RPMs went to 11,000.
Yeah, so he's going out through the white water, his prop starts to slip, his RPMs went through the roof. He went back to neutral, which caused his engine to die, right?
Yep.
Okay, so...
Overspeed.
Yeah, overspeed. So it takes, yeah, beyond your throttle. Absolutely. Okay, I'm running out of time, so I'm going to go. Okay. This is the right way to do it. These guys are crossing a pretty tough bar, and they're doing it with just the right amount of speed. Now, this guy loses his hat. There's some water coming on board. You don't want to be in this situation, but... It's survival. This one is especially good. That's pretty good. That's pretty good boat handling right there. Okay, so five factors. Everybody know what they are? Let's hear the first one.
Outbound.
Another one.
Inbound.
Okay, what's next?
Fog,
yeah.
Sea conditions,
good. Trends, yay. Okay, you got it? Homework. Come up here and grab one of these, and what you'll find in here is screenshots of Windy TV. Yeah. Swell watch and whatnot.
Hang on, stay where you're at.
And this is for October 13th of last year, I just think today. And there's a place.
You have to pick the 13th?
Well,
those are both the same, so.
That's all the data I have, so.
Hold on, hang on, stay where you're at.
Okay, so. All right, so you get the circle go, no go for each of the five factors, a little exercise. I'll be at Yoda's Lounge today and tomorrow if you have questions.
I think I'm done.
First of all, how about a big thank you to Dan.